please. Be seated. We're here today to celebrate a life. We're here today to celebrate a life lived well. And some of you will know her as Teresa. Some will know her as Terry. Others will know her as mom, wife, grandma. And you have different parts of her life that you'll remember. We're going to look at her life today, and I just, as I get started this morning, I want to introduce myself. I'm David Looney. I'm a chaplain here in Charleston with Hospice Care South Carolina, and been asked to speak today, and just very honored to do that. And I want to just acknowledge everyone that's here in the room today. Thank you for coming. One of the things that we do in hospice is we learn what's called the ministry of presence, because a lot of times when a patient gets older, people don't think that they know that they're there. And one of the things we talk about is they recognize someone's presence, that patient does. And I want to just speak on behalf of the family to everyone that's made an effort to be here today. Your presence is felt. And those that are watching online, I understand we have people watching from Sweden, Washington State, New York, Australia, West Virginia, DC. Am I missing anything? It's just people are watching all over the world. And I want to thank you for tuning in to honor Miss Terry today. And so I want to start with a couple verses. One of the most comforting verses is Psalm 23. Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. May those words bring comfort to us all. Teresa Dianne Sigler of Goose Creek, the wife of Dean Curtis Sigler, entered into eternal rest on Thursday, August the 26th at 2021. She was born in March 27, 1962 in Chattanooga, Tennessee, the daughter of the late Harold Lee Davis and Minnie Jane Hill. She was 24, very important thing to remember, she was 24 days shy of 41 years of continuous sobriety. Wow. Her first 18 years on this earth, she was a hellion. She was a rebel without a cause. Then she found her cause. She spent the next 41 years working with people who were at their lowest point in their lives, working with children who had lost all hope, and working with dogs most people would have put down. She touched the lives of thousands of people, scores of dogs, in a positive way, pulling them from the depths of despair, bringing light into their dark lives, giving them something to live for. She inspired so many. Then God said, "My child, you have completed your task here on earth. You are needed up in heaven." And God called her home at the age of 59 years and 5 months. And this is personal comment. Goodbye, my love. Take care of all of the fur babies. She is survived by her husband, Dean Sigler, son, Sean Lee Sigler of, is that pronounced Saiso? It's in Japan?
Sasebo.
Sasebo. Sorry, my eyes. Japan. And daughter, Sandra Lynn Baker and Craig of Indianapolis, Indiana. Her mother, Jane Hill of Orangeburg, South Carolina. Two brothers, Ron Davis and Tracy of Somerville, South Carolina. Harley Davis of Odessa, Texas. Two sisters, Michelle Robertson and James of Goose Creek. And Natalia Mendez and Christopher of Louisville, Colorado. Grandson, Caleb Baker. And also one thing that was mentioned in there was memorials could be made to the Vicinji Rescue and Transport, which if you were in the other room, you see all the people that have made those donations to what's called BRAT. And that was just another thing the family wants to just thank you so much for continuing that legacy. And what I want to do is just start today with a word of prayer. I want us to pray the serenity prayer, and I'm going to pray that, and then after I pray that, I'd like to invite you to pray the Lord's Prayer with me. Okay. So God, I just pray that you grant me the serenity to accept the things I cannot change, the courage to change the things I can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Living one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardship as a pathway to peace, taking as Jesus did this sinful world as it is, not as I would have it, trusting that you will make all things right if I surrender to your will, so that I may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with you forever in the next. Let's pray the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, thy power, and glory, forever and ever. So I'm going to we're going to play a song right now that was one of her favorite songs, but it really just speaks to what happened in her life, and that was being set free from chains, and she always gave credit to God. She gave credit to Jesus for setting her free because of his amazing grace.
Saved a wretch like me.
One of her favorite poems was, "One night I dreamed a dream. As I was walking along the beach with my Lord, across the dark sky flashed scenes from my life. For each scene I noticed two sets of footprints in the sand, one belonging to me and one to my Lord. After the last scene of my life flashed before me, I looked back at the footprints in the sand, and I noticed that at many times along the path of my life, especially at the lowest and saddest times, that there was only one set of footprints. This really troubled me, so I asked the Lord about it. Lord, you said once I decided to follow you, you'd walk with me all the way. But I noticed during the saddest and most troublesome times of my life, there was only one set of footprints. I don't understand why. When I needed you the most, why you would leave me. And he whispered, my precious child, I love you and I will never leave you. Never, ever during your trials and testings, when you saw only one set of footprints, it was then that I carried you." That poem's Footprints in the Sand. What a powerful testimony her life, what had happened to her. Today, I wanted to just transition here for a moment into just a time of remembrance, some personal memories, and I want to invite, if there is anyone, I've talked to the family about this, if there's somebody here today that you would want to share a story or a memory, some type of word of encouragement, that open invitation in just a moment is going to be there. And but this is a very important thing. I think about this moment in my life where I was a teenager and I would leave the house. I was the youngest of four sons, and when I would leave my house, I had a habit of leaving the doors open, not even closed. Don't turn off the lights. Didn't turn the television off. And so, you know, you hear those statements as a teenager, or you trying to cool the outdoors and just stuff from your parents, you know. But one thing that my dad would always say is, hey, make sure when you leave, make sure you lock the door and turn off the lights. But I want to kind of turn that around today, and I want to just say, as we remember Terry, as we remember Teresa, today let's keep the lights on. Keep her light alive, and that's what you are doing by making those contributions and being here today. I want to read something from Matthew chapter 5. Jesus said, he said to his disciples, he said, "You are the light of the world. You're a town built on a hill that cannot be hidden." He said, "Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it up on a stand so it will give everyone in the house light." In the same way, Jesus said to them, he said, "Let your light shine before others that they may see your good deeds, that they will glorify your Father in heaven." So when we remember Terry today, I want to just say, let that light shine. Hold the light up brightly, and it will not be forgotten. And I'm reminded, and another thing I want to tell you is, one thing I've learned talking to Sandy and Mr. Dean is just how goal-oriented Terry was. When she set out to do something, and many of you, I'm looking around, many of you shook your head yes, so you know if she wanted to get something done, she was going to get it done. And so I want you to remember those moments. It's just like, I am going to make this happen. You don't just wake up one day and decide you're going to get a master's degree. You don't just do that. There has to be something, and we'll talk about that, how she went from a GED, created from the South Carolina Girls School, to a Bachelor's of Theology, to a Bachelor's of Theological Counseling to try to help other people, and eventually got a Master's degree in Community Psychology. That's somebody who set out to change the world. And that's why we have people looking in and checking in from around the world today. I'm reminded of a patient that I had about 7 or 8 years ago that was a judge. And every time I would visit her, she couldn't remember my name most of the time. She didn't really know where she was most of the time. She Parkinson's had just wrecked her body, her memory. But sometimes we would have some conversations. Well, on this particular visit, as I walked into her room, one of the family members had told her that I just had a wreck, and that I had, you know, that I was okay. But and she got curious about it. So when I got there for my visit with her, normally I would read scripture, pray a prayer, do the spiritual thing. She started asking me questions about my wreck, and eventually this conversation turned into a deposition, to where the way she questioned me, it was I could only answer yes, no, and she put me in a corner she found out that I was the one at fault for the wreck, which I was. I got the ticket, and it cost me a little bit of money and insurance, all that. She was right there. Her family was watching this, and ultimately, at the very end, she said, "Well, son, did you pay your ticket?" And I said, "Yes, ma'am, I sure did." And she said, "Well, if you paid your ticket and everything's taken care of, you're dismissed." And this is a person who didn't, and that must have been one of her movements, "You're dismissed." And so I kind of laughed, because I thought, was that what you normally do? And I'm even talking to her real loud. "Is that what you do in your courtroom?" And she said, "Young man," I said, "you're dismissed. Get out of here." And she kicked me out of the room. And I'm not joking. And I walked out. I was like, tail between my legs, "Let's get out of here." And because I was hoping she'd say, "No, come back," or whatever. But the reason I tell that story is the joy that brought her family, at my expense, was because they got to see her doing something she loved again. She loved being a judge. She loved being a lawyer. And she loved that moment. And that was just one of those moments where I want to just encourage you, tell each other those stories. Just tell, whatever comes to your mind, all of the beautiful moments of her impacting other people, and just share them. Send them in emails, and it will continue to keep her legacy alive. And I want to invite, if there's anyone here at this moment, if anybody wants to speak or wants to say anything or tell a story, you are invited to do that.
difficulty believing that we're here for this, because this is a lady that was taken way too young and will be sadly missed. But in life, you can go decades or your whole life and never meet somebody that truly changes lives and changes the world. Dean and Terry both are those kind of people. People that change the world, change hearts, change minds, change souls, among two-footed and four-footed inhabitants of this world, and all in a good way. And I look at Terry's life like a pebble thrown onto the water. Yes, that pebble disappears from view, but the ripples that she created go on and on and on. Dean and Terry have touched so many people, including us. And it's just amazing to have been touched by her. And I know Dean will miss her terribly. I hope he gains strength from the fact that so many lives have been touched and by her. And I have to say, even watching what we knew of a small part of her, watching the videos shows you how diverse and dynamic this amazing lady's life was. I'm absolutely honored to have known her. I'm honored to still know Dean, and he continues to touch hearts and souls. And we need him around a long time, so I hope the knowing how many people loved her helps get him through a rough time. And just in a little personal story, we met them because we were involved with Basenjis from the time we got married. We obtained a Basenji as our first. My wife wanted one, saw one, we knew nothing about the breed, and we got a Basenji as our first anniversary gift, my gift to her. And after 42 years in Basenjis, we finally said, okay, enough. Our last one passed, and we, our daughter and son-in-law have moved to the Netherlands. We thought we'd be traveling a lot, and so we were really done with dogs. But we would pull into the driveway and look at the front door, and my wife would go, there's no little faces there looking for us. There's no one, no tails to greet us when we get home. And in their outreach of good, as always, Terry and Dean adopted Seamus. And my wife saw this dog online and said, oh, that just looks amazing. Dean and Terry stopped by. We got to meet Seamus. My wife fell in love with Seamus. I was a little more hesitant. Big dog, going no dog, big dog. And shortly thereafter, when we actually met Seamus, he jumped on me as I came home from work, put his paws on my shoulder and gave me a mooch, and that was it. We were hooked, and less than a year later, we had two greyhounds, which Seamus thankfully met and got to actually enjoy some time with a greyhound rather than crazy Basenjis. And so Dean and Terry's shining a light into our lives continues every time we go home, pull in that driveway, and there's two smiling faces in the window. And we so love them. We love them both. Dean, please be strong. I know Terry is looking down on you and saying, keep going, keep going, keep going. She's loved you still.
So I just want to let you all know that I have caused lots of trauma in the last couple of weeks because of my uncanny resemblance to my mother. People think that we are twins, and she never aged, so that is perfect, right? So that's been a very interesting and also sad thing, because I don't like causing trauma in people's lives. I kind of I didn't fall too far from the tree. I'm a teacher, so that, you know, counts as social work and counseling. But my mom and dad have become a very big part of the Basenji crew, and part of that is my fault, and I apologize, but then again, I don't. So we went to the Humane Society very young in our marriage, thinking, we've got this, we're gonna rescue a dog, yes. Well, this dog was the cutest. Oh my gosh, this was the cutest dog ever. It looked like a little beagle mix, had the cutest little face. She was adorable. And then we got her home. And then she wrecked our home. And she chewed through some steel cables and tried to choke herself by jumping over a fence. Are you serious? You're trying to jump over the, like, no, she climbed up the fence, and on the other side of the fence, she was hanging herself. Oh, yeah, before we got a chance to get back outside, she climbed back over. No, she wasn't gonna die that way. We were not ready for a Basenji. I definitely applaud you. We were not ready for the Basenji, and my parents fell in love with her as soon as they saw her and had to keep her. I did not know what they were doing, but they had a great Dane at the time. So the best thing that happened for Willow was the Great Dane, because the Great Dane stopped her from being as crazy as she was, but it also brought this level of joy into their lives. And whenever we went over, we got to see this dog that, you know, we had failed with. We were terrible. it was bad. But we got to see her in a place where she was loved by my parents. So that was definitely something that I got to see them succeed in a time that we had failed. And that was really awesome, because throughout my life, I kept succeeding, and Mom felt like she kept failing. So this was a different aspect, and she got to see this. And this last few months, she has been the happiest I've ever seen her. And I know I wasn't here with her, but I got to see her happy. I got to see pictures. I got to talk to her, hear the joy in her voice, and she loved being here. Kristen, she loves you so much. She loves all of you, but honey, she loves you so much. And I just need you to know that you filled in that daughter space for her that I wasn't able to fill while she was here. And I love and adore that for her and for you. And I just need you to know that. And your daughter has been a joy that she fought for from the time that you knew. So just know that she loves you, and she is all about you, all about your daughter. And it was pretty amazing to see.
Thank you, Sandy. I sent an email with just a few questions. And by the way, I'm one of those people that Basenjis are, I'm learning more this week about Basenjis I have in my whole life. So I guess everybody in the room knows about them except for me, because nobody left. All right. Here just a couple questions I had. If you could describe Terry in five words, what would they be? God, and then Basenjis, family, rescuer, and recovery. I love that. Just any kind of story, and Sandy just shared about her always wanting to save teenagers. She'd drive her way, make large sacrifices to ensure that teens who were in abusive homes, if they were addicted to drugs or alcohol, and or any type of trouble, she was wanting to give them a way out. She took in neighborhood teenagers and provide a safe place for them. And it's a lot of those situations. One comment that came up from Dean and Sandy was, you know, there's a lot of things she wasn't in control. God was bringing her through it. God would help her to be able to help other people. Favorite memory is going to the beach, in South Carolina during the summer, finding starfish and shells, sandcastles, visiting with family. She always loved being at the beach. Three best qualities: sacrificial love, love for the forgotten, love for people who've been thrown away, and a faithful servant of Christ. And she fully believed in the Holy Trinity. She always talked about how God delivered her from herself, that he forgave her daily, and she could never live up to the sacrifice that Christ paid for her. She tried over and over to show that love and that rescue, and that she's sharing that peace with others. Some of her favorite songs, Amazing Grace, we just heard, Joy to the World, just one, we're going to hear another song. She loved all kinds of music, but there was something special about some of those songs. One thing, she loved being a grandma. She loved spending time with her grandson, Caleb, and truly adored him. So proud of who he's becoming, wanted the best for him, and would have spoiled him to pieces if he would let her. And I love that. Yeah, that's true. Parents would love it. That's good. This is a couple other things just to note. She was a black belt, third degree in karate. We talked about the school she went to, but then as she started her education, you can see that what she was doing was to help other people. She wanted to give peace. She wanted to give up whatever God had given her. And I just want to say, as someone who's been through recovery myself, I'm just really happy for people like you, Dean, and her, that have been impactful even in my life from a personal perspective. And just keep it up, because you're looking at somebody who's been helped, okay? I didn't put that in my notes, sorry. But I wanted just to, there was just a poem that Sandy gave me just a few minutes, and this is from Miss Emily, and I don't know if Miss Emily's here today. Okay. And this was a poem that, and one of the things that was commented, that when she read this poem, she knew that Terry was going to be okay. So this is written in 1977, and it says, Terry Davis, Bluebird of Happiness. Bluebird of happiness in the tree, is there a place of happiness just for me? Bluebird of happiness flying so high, do me a favor and search the sky. Bluebird of happiness flying so free, thank you for finding a place for me. I think that's a beautiful, beautiful poem from her. And one of the things that we want to do in a time like this, as we're looking at her being rescued, her rescuing other people, reaching out, and then now she's in the presence of the Lord. We wanted to play this song. This is another special song, and it's called No Scars.
Stayed a little longer tears fall down. The only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walk was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken.
In John chapter 14, Jesus says those powerful words. He says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. And he's talking to his disciples. But there, one thing we don't realize is the reason he's telling them this is because he's just told them that he's going to die. He just told them that I'm going to be returning to my Father in heaven. And it's after he had just told them, the scripture says that the disciples were, they were perplexed, they were scared, they were upset. And that's when he looked at them and he said, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions. And he says, if it were not so, I would have told you. I'm going to prepare a place for you, that where I am, there you may be also. And that's the hope that we have today, is that Terry is in the presence of the person who gave his life, with the scars in his hands, the scars in his feet and in his side, and that she's celebrating with him today in heaven. I love that verse, and I love that whole chapter, because what it speaks of is what she was given to other people, and that's what Jesus gives to us, and that is peace. He's given us peace that passes even our understanding. And it's in times like this, I just wanted to, you know, as we honor her, we honor God, but we also want to speak peace over you, over the family that's here today. And I'm reminded in Mark chapter 4, where Jesus had just fed the 5,000, and the scripture says he was really tired, and he got on a boat, and they went out into a boat, and he got to the bottom of the boat and he's asleep. And if you read the whole chapter, you'll see where a storm, a tempest comes up. And remember, the disciples, his disciples were fishermen, most of them, and they saw this storm, and the scripture says that they were sorely afraid. They were thinking they're going to die. It was that bad of a storm. But we need to look at what happened with Jesus in that moment when they reached out to him. They said, "We're going to perish, Jesus." And he came up. He said, "Oh, you have a little faith." He said, "You could have done this." And what he does is he turns to that storm. And you know what happens in that moment. He turns to the storm and he says, "Peace, be still." He spoke to the storm. The scripture says the storm completely calmed down. Just completely calmed down. He's a peace speaker. And that's one thing I was just reminded earlier today. That was one of the things that she was doing in her life. She had become she was imitating Christ in that way of speaking peace into other people's lives who were going through the hardest times, addictions, abuse, whatever was happening. She was trying her best to speak peace into them, not from a place of hurt, but a place of healing, where she had already been healed. And that's what I just wanted to say. And so that peace, I think today, you that are here, we speak peace over this family. You're in the middle of a storm. This is a storm. There's a grieving that's going to happen. There's a loss that happens. We speak peace to you today. Peace be still to your hearts. But I also can't make this kind of statement today without the knowledge that there might be someone in this room who's had a bad diagnosis from a doctor this week. We've all just we're still living through a pandemic in our country. I believe for everyone that's in this room, I just want to say to you, peace. Be still and speak peace over your life. Maybe there's broken relationships. Peace, be still. Maybe you've lost a job. Finances are in just horrible shape. Peace, be still. Maybe you're still fighting addiction in your life. Peace, be still. And I think her voice, if she were here, she would be saying it as well to us out loud. You know, when I was young, my mother would sing us songs. Like I told you, I have three older brothers, and at one point we were in this small house, and all four of us were in the same bedroom. We were all under 13 and under, and she would come and sing songs to us at night, and it would be, this is before you had Barney and all those type of songs, but it would just be whatever songs that she would sing us. And since my dad was a pastor, she always had to throw in a hymn or two, you know, and that was the songs we didn't like. But this song, she taught it to us, talked to me 55 years ago or so, and I want to just sing a little bit of it today to you that are here. And it's just called Peace, Wonderful Peace, and it goes, peace, peace, wonderful peace, coming down from the Father above, sweep over my spirit forever, I pray, in fathomless billows of love. So we do speak peace over you, Dean, over you, family members, and just want to just ask that God will restore to your heart, just as we read from Psalm 23, that he will restore your soul. And as we end this service today, I just wanted to do the benediction, which is from Numbers chapter 6, verse 24, where he speaks a blessing of peace. And before I say that, I want to just talk about, just real quickly, about the peace that passes understanding. David said in the Psalms, he said, "I will lay down and I will sleep because you keep me in perfect peace. You keep my mind in peace." And I think about myself, how I lay down at nights and I toss and turn and I think I should have said that, I should have done this. I will toss and turn tonight. Why didn't I say that at the service? You know, Sandy, beautiful thing. So just let God do whatever he wants to do today and do your best. You know, but I'm just like anybody else. But David said, I'm going to lay down and I'm going to sleep because you keep me in perfect peace. So that's what I want to pray for you as a family. And if you would, bow your head as I pray this benediction. The Lord bless thee and the Lord keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee. And the Lord be gracious unto thee. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon thee. And may he give you peace. And everybody said, amen.